Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. Folks, let me say that we're going to reschedule the former Governor Vicar Tia piece. We're going to do that next week. We just had some issues that we figured that we maybe had to do that next week to do a good show. So join us next week, and we'll pay tribute to former Governor Vicar Tia, and I'll probably have a guest with me during that particular time also, too. And as usual, you notice I'm donning my Vietnam cap on, and you know, and as you note, there were many of us that that spent time during that particular era in the Vietnam War, and veterans issues had been a major issue, and still is a major issue. And now maybe some of the solutions are happening. It just so happened that today there was last week, I think they announced the fact that $8 million of a couple of billion dollars was sent to Oregon. To the local Oregon VA on the Hill to accommodate the vets. And so I would hope that those who are, whether family members or vets and whatever, I would hope you hear this message and get your folks up there on the Hill. If you got issues or problems and whatever, it has been diagnosed that many Vietnam vets had post-traumatic stress, PTS, but unfortunately, That wasn't the deal during that particular time. It only happened after the reserves got in and the Iraqi war and things of that nature. But the fact of the matter is, they will accommodate you, and whether it be from a medication standpoint or anything of that nature, or just sit down and chat with you or whatever. So please get those vets up there to the VA Center and take advantage of those opportunities. Okay. Well, now, what we're going to do now in lieu of the former Governor Vicar Tia situation, I got an issue here that I think you would be very interested in, and talking about the crisis we recently had on the whole issue of water. It was really a crisis there for a moment. All of a sudden, in the Portland metropolitan area, there was a shutdown, if you will, of the water system for the entire city of Portland. And all of a sudden, there was this big rush to all of the neighborhood stores buying water, bottled water, and they ran out. And in fact, it was such a crisis that for about a day or two, people are trying to figure out, well, what am I going to do in the future? If they run out of water, what do I drink? I can't drink tap water. What do I do? So I said, well, dude, I went out and I did a little bit more research on some of the stuff. And as you know, there are entities out there that are basically producing, i.e. machines, that will basically correct, if you will, some of the issues that we're having with water, good clean water. And there's a medical situation. My point is that I went out and I did as much research as I could. I even went to YouTube and I checked out some stuff and whatever. But then I said, well, I need to find someone or some entity that I might be able to be able to come on the show and talk about the whole issue of water. I didn't have the time to go back to school and all of a sudden be an expert on water, per se. But I've got two guys who are willing to come on. And they've been in this in the water business aspect of it, but a number of others that I talked to also too. But I felt that these two guys had a little bit more knowledge about not just basically talking about what they were doing in terms of selling, but the whole issue of water. And I think that was very important. So I'm going to introduce you to two guys, Doug Chambers, who's right here, Water Solutions. Both of these guys from Water Solutions, and Tommy Carlisle from Water Solutions. Welcome, guys.
Thank you, Bruce. Thanks, good, nice
good,
to
good,
be
good,
here.
Good, good. Well, as you know, when we were talking, as I indicated when I approached you guys, I was talking about this crisis aspect of it, and I picked you guys because we talked a little bit more than just you trying to sell me some water or something. And you weren't in the bottle business. I was wanting to be in there a little bit more. I couldn't get to the corporations or whatever along that line, but you guys brought up some very interesting points about water and the need to get good water and whatever, and the health of it and all this other good stuff. So
absolutely.
That's what we want to talk about today. And I want to thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to chat with you all about that piece. And from
You're
a
welcome.
Lay standpoint, we're not talking about, some professor or something about this. You guys are just very lay people that have been out in this business, okay?
For sure.
Sounds good. Well, why don't we start off with, let's say, let's define a little bit about what one were you for me with the crisis. You remember that crisis?
I've heard about it. Yeah, I saw on the internet and the paper. E. coli is no friendly. That's no friendly organism to be drinking. That's for sure. And I think that's the one you're talking about.
Right,
is the
exactly.
E. coli getting in the water through the reservoirs, I believe, and
exactly.
through the pipes. That's a scary situation, and it's not only here in Portland. You read about that across the country, with even raw sewage entering the public drinking water and many other organisms too that can be present in public water. It's a difficult.
Well, you know, on that same point, you know, we have an open reservoir here in the Portland metropolitan area, and you think about ducks, geese, and all kinds of stuff. That is raw sewage.
You
can't get further than raw sewage. That is raw sewage too.
Right.
And then, like you say, sometimes stuff fall into the river, right? We went through a sewage plant thing that we just built not too long ago. I mean, the water was sewage was dropping into the water.
Backing up, sure.
Backing up in the water.
I remember that.
And you hear all kinds of stuff. Talk about that a little bit more, will you?
Boy, it's a tough issue because, you know, 300 years ago, we didn't have to deal with this. You'd go down to the stream and fill up a bucket and bring it back to the house, and that's what you drank. You had natural, pure water. Everyone had it. But, you know, with the industrial age, people moving to cities and so forth, I think the first case of chlorine being added was in Chicago in 1906. And there was typhus or typhoid or some waterborne illness that got in the water, and to bring it to the homes, they had to kill it first, so they started using chlorine there.
Sort of disinfecting.
Yes, they had to disinfect that water, and it's, you know, now water systems are very complex, and some of the pipes are very expensive to change. Some of the pipes in Portland, I'm sure, are 100 years old or 80 years old.
Then
or
the
so
lead
forth.
Factor, right?
You got, yes.
I heard about that. Let's talk a little bit about that lead.
Lead is, according to the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, Georgia, 8 million children have high doses of lead, and a lot of it is from their drinking water. They took copper pipe used to be soldered with a lead-based solder. That stopped in middle 1980s. Some of the plumbers still had supplies of it and kept using it. But some of the pipes, copper pipes, are old, and you're getting lead that way. You know, it's a big way that children are getting lead.
Well, you know, you make a good point, because in certain aspect, in certain sections of the poor community, if you will, the older community, you have
older homes, right?
You got pipes, if you will, and then and they're still there in some of these older homes.
They don't
change them if you don't have the money to actually change your old system.
Right. Well, that's not cost effective. Well, how about the pipe that leads to the house, too?
No, just
that's going down the street.
Yeah.
You know?
That's a good point, because California, not too long ago, I think it was last week or so, I guess, some big pipe at burst. Remember that?
Yes.
And they found out it was an old pipe, if you will, and that stuff was running through that kind of stuff. Are you drinking something?
Well, they get it to our homes. You know, it's up to us, in my opinion, to change it. With what you have can be altered and make it a healthy drink. The city is going to tell you it's healthy. If you can print out the 2014, whatever city you're in the country, you can print out the water quality report, and it's going to tell you exactly what's in it. In some cities, there's chromium 6. I mean, there's some nasty chloramines, cryptosporidium. Cryptosporidium is an organism that chlorine will not kill. It's an organism. Small organism like a parasite, the chlorine won't kill, and that's in the water.
Really? What is that? Cryptosporidium. I saw that. That word in
nasty
in
little creature.
In Salem, I think they're having some problems with that.
It's pretty much everywhere.
And wow.
So I mean, it's not the city's fault. The pipes are bad.
Right. Okay.
Managing that much water would be very expensive to change to fresh new pipes every 10 years or so.
Wow. Really.
I mean, it's pretty much sterile. When you go to other countries, their water is horrible compared to ours. But we have a lot of. I just read a report by the Associated Press. They did a detailed report about pharmaceutical drugs being dumped into the water supply. 250 million pounds last year of hormones, birth control, tranquilizers, all that was dumped into the water supply. The filtering system most cities use will not filter that out, and it's getting through the water. So we're drinking that if you don't take it a step further and refilter some of that water.
Have you done anything in regards to the Portland area at all, in terms of look what kind of water, what kind of water quality?
One of the things we know is that in order for the water to come to your house, it's got to be neutral.
Neutral.
And they do all kinds of things to make it 7.0 on the pH scale.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
And what they do is they add stuff to it to get it to that before it gets to your house. So it comes to your house as clean as they can make it.
Okay.
But unfortunately, some of the things they dump into it to do that is like lye, you know.
That would amaze most people to know that there's lye added to the water. Lye. The reason why, if the water is too acidic and pH scale 7 is neutral, if you get down to 5 or so, that's 100 times more acidic. The pH scale is logarithmic.
What is pH? I mean, what you
potential of hydrogen. It's a neutral. You remember back in high school, you had the base and the acid, right?
Oh, okay.
Okay, so there's acidic is less than 7. Alkaline is more than 7.
Okay.
If what's running through the pipes is acidic, it's going to rust those pipes out.
Okay.
So they have to make that water alkaline. The sterilizers they put in the water, chlorine and stuff, makes it acidic, right? So to raise that pH so it doesn't rust the pipes, they could protect the pipes, they add lye. Lye is not a friendly thing
to drink.
Because
they were using galvanized pipes more than anything else.
Right.
As opposed to
and
copper,
and they're still
right?
there. You still see galvanized
and you still got galvanized pipes.
Yeah. So it's federally mandated the water supply has to be 7.0, has to be neutral.
Okay.
So they're adding stuff one way or the other to keep it at 7.
Are they testing this stuff as it goes out?
Yeah.
But then it goes through the system. Do they test it on the other end by the time it gets to the water?
That's the problem right there.
Have you ever had them come to your house and test your water?
No.
It doesn't happen very often.
Wow.
But there's testing kits you can buy. Yeah. There's local labs that you can take your water supply to them, and they'll test it for $50 and tell you exactly what you got going
$50?
Yeah. Or you could buy a kit for $12.
Right,
depending on how sophisticated a test.
But if
you have a well, you really need a huge spectrum of things to test for. Arsenic's a deadly killer, and there's a lot of arsenic up here naturally occurring in the Northwest. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's kind of interesting. So maybe it's constantly like the gas, if you will. The gas company is only responsible to run the gas to you to one point.
To your point.
And then from that point to your house, that's your responsibility. So you have to pick up the tab.
Or the electric. They'll run it to your house, to the box, and that's their end of their responsibility from there on.
But now the water deal, they should be responsible from the plant.
Wouldn't that be
to
nice?
The house.
Wouldn't that be
so
nice?
Then they got to replace it. But they don't do that. Right?
I mean, I don't know what the cost would be. The numbers would be huge.
Yeah.
Plumbers would be rich.
Wow.
But,
wow.
The numbers would be huge.
Well, you know, thinking about that that crisis situation when all of a sudden people are just running out there just buying bottled water aspect, that could be, all of a sudden, if you had to just basically buy bottled water, let's talk about the requirements, if you will. You know, from a medical standpoint, they're constantly saying, well, you should drink so many glasses of water.
Yeah, most people, if you ask them, they know the doctor's going to tell you 6 to 8, 10 glasses a day of water is what you need to keep hydrated. Mm-hmm. And the reason you need to keep hydrated, water's the great solvent. It's a carrier of protein into your cells, and it also enters the cell and takes out the waste products.
Mm-hmm.
So there's an ash that's created that's acidic, and it needs to wash that out to keep, like a fishbowl, right? If the fish is in there eating and digesting and doing his thing, if that water didn't get changed out, it's going to get stagnant and nasty, and it's the same with our cells.
Hmm.
So the less hydrated you are, your cells become acidic, and then you start getting onset diseases, arthritis. There's millions of them. What, diabetes, onset diabetes, that they're saying now that that's one of the main reasons people are getting onset diabetes, not type 1, but type 2, right?
Okay, right?
A lot of it's lack of exercise and sedentary, but I mean, a big part of it is being overly acidic.
You need that filtering system.
Yes, you need that filtering system. So.
And about, 30 years ago, onset diabetes for children was unheard of, and now it's rampant.
Why is that so, Tom?
I think that it's got a lot to do with what we eat and what we drink.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of kids are drinking soda pop like crazy.
They're
you know, when I was a kid, it was lemonade or orange juice. Mm. You know what I mean? Something
so
more healthy.
Pop is a problem.
Oh, yeah. Big time problem.
But we still sell it.
Well, freedom of choice, right?
Yeah.
Well, you notice that Coca-Cola and Pepsi, they're number one in sales is their Dasani and their, what's that other one?
Aquafina. Bottled water, sort of
hot.
They
make more money on that than they do with their pop anymore.
Right. So is the trends are changing.
Water.
Yes, the trends are changing away from pop, more into the sports drinks and bottled waters.
Yeah.
But when you look at those on a pH scale, again, we've been talking about pH, they have a pH of pop is 2.5. That is liquid death as far as your body goes. Your blood is going to stay at 7.3 to 7.4, a tight range.
Mm-hmm.
If it drops below 7, you may have a stroke. If you get down to 6.5, you're on death's door. So it's going to stay there. So what it does when you get acidic, your body is how it balances it. It takes alkaline minerals. Now you're born with some reserves, right? But you've spent those. The American diet, you spent those a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
Now it starts taking those minerals from your bones. That's why people get osteoarthritis like I used to have.
Hmm.
Terrible. So the minerals are being taken from your bones, from your connective tissue, from your teeth.
Hmm.
So that's the balance. And it's a fact. Your blood is going to stay right there. You can't, if you drank soda pop all day, it's going to be robbing minerals like crazy. You're going to be arthritic. You're going to be diabetic. And a simple change of good, clean water and get away from some of that fast food.
So in order to replace those at time one, you got to stop drinking pop.
Absolutely.
And start drinking another liquid, if you will, that doesn't do that.
Right. Some of those other products are just as bad, though. The Gatorade, even, is not a health product.
Really?
Well, I test these things for people and prove it to them, but I mean, you can test it. There's a couple simple tests, a pH test, and we've heard of oxidation and free radicals. You familiar with you guys?
No, what's a free radical?
Free radical is a very simple thing.
I know some, but
free radical damage is what creates havoc in our cells and alters our DNA, right? And free radicals is basically a molecule that's missing an electron, right?
Okay.
They're like little satellites.
Right.
Just missing an electron.
Okay.
It's going to get in you. It's going to steal one from the neighbor, wherever it lands in your body.
Okay.
And that starts a chain reaction. It weakens that cell, right? It weakens that molecule when it's a thief, right?
Okay.
And if that cell is not strong enough, it's going to start robbing to the neighbor. Pretty soon you've got a whole area, then pretty soon a whole organ, unless you're an antioxidant, right? We're talking about this is oxidation, the taking of electrons. An antioxidant has extra electrons to donate. That's all it is. So that's how I see it. When I used to hear about free radicals, my mind works where I have to see a picture of it. I'm thinking, is this some lousy organism or what is it? But we're bombarded with free radicals due to our cell phone use, our stressful lives we lead. We're spending too much time not getting exercise. I mean, we're under attack by free radicals like we never have been in the history of mankind.
Mm-hmm.
So we need heavy duty antioxidants, or you're going to, cancer, they say one out of two of us, at some point in our life.
And so that's why you bring in either the water. It's sort of like the good substitute, good water.
There is water that, in Japan, they restructure water, and it gathers the electrons from the natural occurring minerals in the water, and it's the highest level of antioxidant by 1,000 times of anything else on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been using it in hospitals there for 40 years. It's an amazing, amazing different way of seeing it. So you can eat blueberries, or most people think of blueberries and they think of an antioxidant, but you'd have to eat a truckload as compared to a gallon of this water.
Really? I mean,
you can't get enough in you.
Really?
Very simple, just to drink this
antioxidant-rich
water.
Wow.
And keep yourself healthy.
And you hear a lot about people saying, well, gee, I drink 4 or 5, how many glasses a day?
Get to 10, 8 to 10, your doctor is going to tell you.
How many glasses are in a bottle of water? 2, maybe?
Yeah, a cup is 8 ounces.
8 ounces of water, that's a glass. They say
8 ounces. What's the bottle?
Well, 8 times 10. So you need 2-3 quarts.
2 or 3 quarts.
Yeah.
So how many bottles is that a day?
Well, how many ounces? I don't drink those bottles.
16 ounces.
16 plus.
16, right?
Well, you need 2. Oh, I'd say 6 of them. Say 6 of them.
Say 6 of them. 6 of them a day, right?
Yes. And if they're bottled water, the high end would be Fiji or something, which is a couple bucks a piece.
That's
or $3 a piece. Times 6, it could be $20 a day to stay properly hydrated.
$20 a day?
Yes.
Times 30.
Well, times your family. If you got a family, you want to supply for your kids.
Let's figure that out, guys.
I've got a chart I should have brought. It's over $100,000 in the next 15 years. Not Fiji, but a regular Costco-type water or whatever.
Okay.
And I mean,
but annually, let's say break something down, just annually. Or let's say monthly. Or let's say weekly.
Weekly,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, let's just say, let's
well, if you're staying hydrated on a bottled water and you're spending, let's say $10, let's take half of that.
Right,
say $5.
Right.
And it's just for yourself. 7 days. There's no days off with
that's
needs for hydration.
Okay.
Right. That's $35 a week.
$35 a week.
52 weeks in a year. I don't know if anybody's got a calculator, but.
Gee, and then if you got family, right? Kids and.
Oh, absolutely.
Then you got 4 times that.
Yeah. Okay. I make sure I've got 4 boys and. When I've read the statistics about, especially men, we have a worse time with cancer than women do. We get it more than the women do.
Why is that?
I don't know. It's not fair. Yeah. Maybe we smoke more. Maybe we drink more. I don't know. Okay. These are probably factors, I would guess. You know, our jobs are more industrial and being around more chemicals and things like that. I would think that's probably part of it, too. But, you know, when I heard that, I was going to make sure that my sons are hydrated because I understood. I've always been into a healthy diet, trying to eat what's right.
Right.
And homemade food is better than fast food. I don't know if I can mention your restaurant. It's great. It's all good home cooking.
It's normal.
That's great cooking. You know, stuff like that is what we need to eat. We don't need to pull into McDonald's. I don't know if you want me saying that or not. But, I mean, this type of fast food is I think we all know it, is not the healthiest option. Maybe once in a while, not on a daily basis.
There are people that eat that every day.
You know, you
bring up a good point, too, in terms of we should be drinking right. We should be eating right and whatever.
Absolutely.
But in our country, you know,
standard American diet is horrible.
Exactly. I mean, it's just our capitalist society. I mean, that's what kind of society we are.
Right.
And we're producing stuff, and in many ways, we're approving it from government standpoint. We're approving it, and there it is.
Well, the corporations are powerful. They're able to lobby in and kind of morph the laws a little bit. You know, with what's the word for it? A lobbyist, you know, they're out there funding senators and stuff to kind of sway their way when the laws. I don't know, it's true, it's a tough one.
Again, getting back to our deal, we got to get some good water here somewhere. I mean, I'm going back to the fact that this crisis aspect of it, that's why I've got you guys.
Water is more important than food.
I hear that.
You cannot live without water. I can fast 7 days. I've seen people fast 30 days without food. You're not going to make it 3 days without water. So water's the key, and I never knew that until about 4 years ago. I always thought it was food. I always thought I got my water through, you know,
vegetables or something.
Yeah, or whatever. A beer. It's got water. It's good. My body doesn't know the difference, but it does. You know, good pure water, and that's what is becoming very rare in the society. You can still buy organic fruits and vegetables. But good, pure, fresh water, like you used to get at Lake Tahoe or something, Mountain Melt. I mean, you can't get that kind of water, and it's not in a bottle.
But you hear the advertisements, you know, like these water folks.
Mountain spring water.
This is mountain spring water. And they get in.
Put a fancy pitcher on the label.
And then every so often you see on 60 Minutes that there's no such thing as a spring water.
Do you want to touch on that bottled water? Yeah.
Well, talk about that bottled water there for me.
One thing is the bottles. That's a horrible thing. You know, we're going to these bottles. People are throwing them away or recycling them in Oregon, of course, and getting their nickels. But those bottles are still ending up out in the ocean. There's a freaking ocean island out there that's as large as Texas.
Really?
Of just plastic.
Wow.
That's floating. Wow.
And it's not just water bottles, it's all kinds of plastic, but plastic's bad.
Right.
And it doesn't just break down, and the fish eat it and kills them, you know.
And then you eat the fish.
Yeah, we eat the fish. So you got the plastic back. It's not good. It's just not good.
Yeah.
I wish the plastic bottles, I think, is just horrible. And they thought that was going to be the save all of everything, you know.
Well, they're cheap to make, you know, and it's basic.
Good water, you get this plastic bottle full of it. And that plastic is leached into that water. Sometimes those plastic bottles are sitting on a dock for 2 years before they even get in a store.
Right. Wow. In the heat.
And they will leach the plastic because that water is acidic to begin with. It's not alkaline.
Spend a little bit more time, because I think some folks are out there saying, well, you keep saying the word acidic. Talk a little bit more about the acidic.
Well, I drink alkaline water on a daily basis.
What is alkaline water?
Alkaline water is above 7 on the pH scale.
Above 7. Ah.
So it's rich in minerals.
It's rich in minerals. Okay. And is that produced? I mean, do you have your own factory or something? I mean, can we tap into your factory or something?
Just give me a call. We'll set it up for you so you can have your own alkaline water.
There's ways of making your own. I get mine
out of my kitchen sink from my tap water.
From your tap water.
And I just change it to what I want.
Okay. Well, in fact, we can get right up in that end of it, because I'm sure an industry, as a result of the seriousness of this, that, and the other, industries have gotten involved in that process, right?
Sure.
And as you know, like I did my research, There are a number of components out there, just like anything else. There are competitors across the board aspect of it, and each has their own.
Right.
And that was the other interesting thing I felt about you guys willing to come on aspect of it. The fact that you've got something that you can take that tap water, it flows into that first, mm-hmm. and basically cleans all that stuff out as much as possible, right? And then mm-hmm. raise that pH factor, right?
Mm-hmm.
And lowers it.
There's uses for both.
For
yeah.
both?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. Oh, tell me about a little bit more than that.
The machine we're talking about splits the water from acid to alkaline, and it comes out of two different spouts.
Okay.
Okay. We've got one water that is very high in alkalinity, and you can actually use it for cleaning stuff. I mean, it's better than bleach. It cleans stuff
really?
So well. And another water that's so acidic that they use it in Japan to sterilize their instruments before surgery.
Seriously. And you can get this out this machine.
It'll kill E. coli, Salmonella.
Really?
I've seen MRSA. When people have had MRSA for years, couldn't get rid of it, they're going to cut a man's thumb off. And I've got pictures of it that I can share with anyone who's interested. But dipped it in a solution of water that had been restructured, the pH of 2.5, which is mainly hydrogen, mm-hmm. with all the positive. So it's basically electron. Has no electrons.
Okay.
So it's going to get in there and eat and kill. It'll kill anything on contact that's a bacteria.
Okay.
Right? They use it, it's approved in the U.S. now as a sterilizer. They use it in the fancy spas and stuff in California now to sterilize instead of using harmful chemicals. They'll sterilize it with water. It's 30% stronger than bleach.
Hmm.
And within 30 seconds, we'll kill staph, E. coli, any of those nasty bacterias. That you can get.
Well, you know,
so it's just an adjustment
right.
of tap water
okay.
can
okay.
be adjusted
right.
from a range of 2.5 up to 11.5, almost 12.
Okay.
11.5 that Tom was talking about that
right.
they use for cleaning. Sanyo is using it in their new wave of dishwashers instead of soap. So there's a soapless dishwasher. It
really?
Emulsifies oil on contact.
Huh.
So anything oily, greasy, it breaks it down. It's the most amazing thing to pour some on some oil. And it looks like a cloud.
Okay.
Normally, you would have an oil slick on top of the water. This breaks down the water.
Hmm.
It's just amazing. There's some amazing things with water.
Well,
you know,
that was one of the reasons why I approached you guys when that crisis hit aspect of it. I was very interested in this stuff. And that was the first thing I said to you guys was right off the bat. I said, okay, this thing happened. You got the alert aspect of it. If I had that piece of equipment, mm-hmm. could I still drink my water even though the water's coming out? Could I still do that?
My opinion, you can. But there's so much electricity going through it that I've never seen any bacteria. I'm friends with a water specialist in Canada. She's been studying wells and different tap waters for over 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And she has personally told me that there's nothing that will live through it, any type of bacteria or organism that'll live through the amount of electricity that's run through. These machines we're talking about have titanium plates that are mm-hmm. coated in surgical grade platinum, right? So they're totally sterile, they're totally conductors with 230 watts of electricity going through them. And that's what breaks down, fractionates the molecule and splits the electrons.
Mm-hmm.
There's a ton of electricity going through there. Mm-hmm. So that'll kill.
So if I was in Portland and that crisis, that alert
I would drink it,
there,
yeah.
I could continue to drink that one. I mean,
absolutely.
I asked you guys that point.
Absolutely.
There's
sure.
no problem. There's yeah. no problem with that piece
no
aspect of it.
No problem. As long as it's in good working order and it's cleaned every year or so,
right.
you know, I wouldn't
right.
let it sit, you know. It's like your car or motor. You're going to want to change your oil and keep mm-hmm. it running sharp.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same thing with these high-grade filters and these machines we're talking about. They just
mm-hmm.
have to be kept in good mm-hmm. working order. Mm-hmm. And then I'd feel totally safe.
And, you know, that's how we start out, the whole idea of this water solution. That's why I got involved in this whole process. Because it could be another crisis again.
And I'm sure there will be.
There most certainly will be.
Yeah, there's no doubt.
And I think about the California. Every time you turn around, there's always something
yeah.
about water. You know what I mean?
And, it's the hottest. It's a hot topic now as far as who owns it.
Right.
What
exactly.
we can do to it.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
How it's carried to
there
your
are
house.
Places you told me that where they won't even let you collect your rainwater. They say that's not yours.
What's that?
Seriously.
Yeah, we talked about
Doug told us about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's becoming common. There's a big battle over who owns water rights. And there are states, I'm not sure if Oregon is one, but the water that comes off your roof, if you want to save it into a barrel and use it in your garden or whatever, they're not letting you do it. And I'm not sure if it's Hawaii. I just read about it a while ago, and I wish I would have written down where. But as far as who owns the water, it's a big political thing, and it's going to be interesting to see what happens. There's a tanker in Alaska, and they're draining a lake that's built in a glacier, millions of gallons, and they paid for the rights to run a pipeline to this down to the port, and they're taking all that water to bottle it and sell it.
To us.
Yeah, now who has the rights to? I don't know how the money worked, you know, but who owned that glacier lake that was sitting up there?
We got a few glaciers running today with the temperatures we've got, right?
Right. Bottled water. I think people know that water is important, but if you knew the truth about bottled water, most of it is just tap water. There's no legislation on bottled water whatsoever.
Right. Wow.
They can run amok. They can put the fancy picture of the glacier on there, and it's from the Detroit River.
Things
like that.
Hey, we need to talk a little bit more about that. What we're going to do, we're going to take a short break. We're back with these two guys, okay, with Doug and Tommy. We'll talk a little bit more about water, okay? We'll take a short break. We'll be right back.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Okay, folks, welcome back again. It's Bruce Burchard, your host here today, and we've got a very interesting subject. I'm responding to the whole issue of the crisis of water here in the Portland metropolitan area. Here, and I've got two guys here that are giving us some good information and sort of educating us from a layman's standpoint about what is water and what is good water and what is unhealthy water and whatever, and its origin and the like. And so, they're not a bunch of scientists, just like myself. The fact of the matter is, I'm just the actual lay person aspect of it. And I do know that there was a crisis. I do know that when I reached for my glass of water, my tap, they told me I couldn't use it anymore. And it concerned me, concerned my family, folks in the neighborhood, the whole nine yard. What do we do? And so that's one of the reasons why I'm doing this particular show, kind of educate you a little bit more about it. Maybe you start asking some questions. In fact, you might even want to call up your water bureau department and maybe take a little deal I think you can go to the city of Portland and whatever and the water bureau and ask them to test your water. What's coming out of your pipe? That's a good point. That's a good start, if you will. Especially if you've got galvanized pipe. If you live in one of these old homes and these antique homes, guess what? You got some problems. If you got copper, but they use lead to put it together, to weld it together, you got problems.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just that we're living in a time now that we've got to be of concern to this piece. And I've got two guys here talking about it. In fact, I got one of the guys right now out of a mason jar. I didn't see any plastic. Is that plastic right there?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
That's a mason jar. That's how I like it.
Mason jar aspect of it.
Not okay. A plastic guy.
Anyway, we've been talking about water. We've been talking about the origin of water and whatever. And these guys have really been filling us up on the way. Well, I did. I really spent some time with them. And so I thought of the two of the folks that I interviewed and talked with, these are the two guys that I felt would fit our mold, if you will. And so now, welcome again, bud.
Thanks.
Good. It's been very interesting. Been very, very, very interesting. We were talking about what comes out of your tap aspect of it. What would have happened had you had this piece of equipment, if you will, that you can continue drinking your water
mm-hmm.
with no problem aspect of it. And it's probably right because you were drinking it, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And then, in fact, as time went on, I spent about a month with you guys, with a lot of the other guys, but as a result of that, I was able to get me some of that good water, and I've been drinking that water from you, Tommy.
Yep.
And I want to thank you very much because it's made a difference within where we are. And the fact that my wife did check that thing out about using it as a cleaner and things of that nature, disinfectant.
Yeah, she told me the other day she got some spots out of some of your clothes.
That's right. That's right. She didn't have to go out and buy no tie. I can't mention that. I can't make a comment of this, that, and the other. You know what I'm saying? But no, it was something else, and I'm just a living proof of the piece that was actually, it did good.
Tasty too, huh?
And very tasty.
Yeah.
With no problem. Very clear too.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I like the clearness.
Thin. A lot of people say it feels thin when they taste it and put it in their mouth.
Now let's talk about comparison. That was the other thing that was very interesting to me in regards to how much we're told that we should be drinking so many glasses per day. Keeping the healthy aspect of it, and that's a costly piece. And then I compared that with as you guys shared with me, how much it would cost me if I was able to get my own machine, mm-hmm. so to speak, to give me that clear water.
Mm-hmm.
And then let's talk about that in terms of
how much did it cost you to make your own with how we do it?
Yeah, right.
About 6 cents a gallon.
6 cents a gallon, mm-hmm. as compared. Well, gee whiz, then you got.
Yeah. As opposed to bottled water,
yeah.
It's.
Six cents a gallon.
It'd save you a fortune.
Wow.
And that's just taking tap water, first filtering it through a double filtering system,
okay.
and then restructuring it, the kind of water full of antioxidants that we've been talking about.
That's part of the machine, too, right?
Yes.
The filtering system. Double filter first. It's all part of the deal.
Yes.
Okay, so.
Yeah.
So.
And there can be more complex filtering systems put in front of the machine if you want.
You can add on.
It's all a la carte. I just take it with the double filtering system. Carbon-based filter, and then run it through the machine and dial up whatever pH I need. Whether I'm an aftershave, I dial it to 5.5 on the pH scale, which is slightly acidic, what your skin wants to be. So women buy these fancy toners and stuff. They don't need to. They can make their own by altering their water. Tightens your skin.
Really?
It'll evaporate wrinkles.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm wrinkled up a little bit. I just started using that
feature. I've done a little ageless as I've been drinking.
So, I mean, that's one of the things I do with it. My drinking water,
that's
I do. My degreasers, I make my own. My sterilizer is very important. I do some contracting, and I get some nasty cuts sometimes that I just swab that pH of 2.5, the one that kills any bacteria,
mm-hmm.
and I'm good. I don't put nothing else on it, mm-hmm. and it's starts healing up tight. I got new pink skin the next day around a nasty
really?
Cut. So, yeah.
You know, they've kind of said the same thing about the DMSO. Remember that one?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You hear that DMSO, the same concept.
Never used it, but yeah.
Well, yeah,
heard about
thing.
It. Yeah.
And, you know, and then they ran that off the market because some of the other big guys couldn't get it.
Right.
Yeah. It was
talking about water.
It was horse medicine or something, something that nature.
Well, this is something that can help people that's non-pharmaceutical. And
mm-hmm.
I mean, that's a whole mm-hmm. different can of worms we can mm-hmm. open if we talk about different healing methods,
mm-hmm.
right?
Right.
According to most medical doctors, if it's not a drug, it can't heal you. You can't use the word cure unless it's pharmaceutical companies have a big power over our medical system, so mm-hmm. I don't know if we want to talk about that. But
well,
this is alternate, but like you said,
it is another issue aspect of it, because I have heard, in fact, my wife made the point about the fact she doesn't take any pills. She tried to avoid taking pills, because in most cases you go to the doctor today, and you know, it's not a family doctor that cures all.
Right.
You got
to
go to specialists.
Right, true.
And each one
true.
Of the specialists gives you pills.
Right.
Take the pill.
And there's a side effect to every one of those.
Exactly.
So pretty soon you're on 20 of them.
Ooh, and then by the way, I'm doing a little research on that, too. I'm planning to bring somebody on.
They give you pills for the pills that you're taking.
Jesus
too.
Christ.
I think the average American over 45 is on 12 or 13 different medications.
Wow.
Is pretty much the average.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Wow. And it's costly, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
Jesus.
I mean, $400 or $500 a month. So I've met people that go to Mexico to save the money, you know, because it's so much cheaper down there, that
mm-hmm.
they'll take a trip and get several months' supply or whatever to save, you know, maybe pay 10% on what they'd pay in America. But I try to avoid them, too, you know.
Wow. Well, now, going back to the water aspect of it, at least you don't have to go to the mountain and cart the water from the mountain, right? You can just cart.
I used to do that when I lived in San Francisco.
Right?
I would drive out into the hills, and there's a pipe sticking out from a spring and I would fill up some gallons and bring it back to town.
Really?
If you've lived in LA or Phoenix or any of these big cities, I just like drinking swimming pool. I mean, it is nasty.
Yes.
Our water here at least tastes decent.
Well, we are getting, I will say that we are getting water from the Bull Run aspect of it. You know, we're getting Bull Run water. And I think Frank Ivansey was the guy that, that put that piece together. Mm-hmm.
There's not much minerals in it. It's pretty much mineral void water, which is the only downside to it.
But it's pretty clear water.
Yeah.
Good water.
Yeah, compared to a lot of places. I mean, the taste wise. Mm-hmm. You know, the chlorine is nasty.
Yeah, but then now all of a sudden, you know, now this idea about the, you know, I never thought about the idea of the ducks and the geese, you know,
I know.
What I mean? Doing the water deal, you know, just whatever, and polluting the water. But now all of a sudden, it's gotten, they're friendly with nice little ducks, you know, you see them on TV just swooping in on the water, you know what I mean? People fishing out the pond and. And,
I don't want to drink that.
In the water, you know, doing all kinds of things. And so now all of a sudden, you know, people are doing things in the waters, you know. And
well, water should be moving. You don't want to drink out of stagnant pool,
that's the other
right?
Thing.
If, say, and you were in the military.
Yep, exactly.
I mean, if there was a stream and say you're survivaling and you're out there somewhere in a combat or whatever, you're out. If you see water that's moving and running,
that's
where
right.
you want to drink.
Exactly.
You don't
exactly.
want to drink in a pond
and
where it's sitting.
And we drop a pill in there.
Well, okay, right, to protect yourself.
Now we drop a big loaf of bread pill in there. I still remember those days when I was out there on the field. And, you know, we had those pills, you know what I mean?
Sure.
You put in there,
right, right, because you don't know what's upstream.
You don't know what it is.
Right.
You don't know what it is, but you're
right. But moving water, it's oxygenated, it's running over rocks and gathering minerals out of it as it tumbles down, and that's the healthier choice as opposed to something that's sitting in a big reservoir. It's not moving, it gets stagnant. You know, it's more like what they'd call dead water in some countries. But another thing to touch on, if I could just
kind of jump in here,
reverse osmosis water, which is what most bottled water is, and we haven't talked about
reverse
that yet.
Reverse osmosis,
it's
talk about
it's a filtering
that.
System, right?
Okay.
It's like pushing water through a cheesecloth or something, but much tighter. It's pressing it through. Some of the downsides are that there's no minerals left in the water. Right?
Okay.
There's nothing left in it.
Okay.
Water is going to try to leach those minerals back. Water almost has a memory when it entered your body. And same with distilled water. Some people say distilled water is good to drink. It is not. And RO water is not either. It's illegal in the UK, United Kingdom, and it's illegal in Japan. A lot of the healthier countries, you won't see RO water. You look at Aquafina, all these waters are reverse osmosis water.
Reverse osmosis.
So it gets in your body, and it's going to start grabbing those electrons. It's going to start grabbing minerals.
Really?
That's yes. It's created for the
mechanics.
And then
they're going out. Right? Then they're going out.
But you need those minerals. Our food doesn't have the minerals it used to 50 years ago.
Hmm.
It's been over-farmed. That's a whole different subject.
Mm-hmm.
But our food is not mineral-rich like it was when we were kids.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
It's void of minerals. So we need those minerals. We can't afford to, you know, we need them. So, I mean, that's another big thing is the RO water is not, it should not be drank. It was invented for the mechanics industry to clean metal. It'd grab those electrons, right, and
that's
clean that
idea.
Metal. And now it became a filtering system and we're drinking it. So
wow.
Yeah, so that's a dangerous one, RO water.
Where's this EPA thing? I mean, you know, we're supposed to be a government of the people, by the people,
right.
for the people.
Right.
I'm paying for this EPA to do those kinds of things. I mean, right? Environmental Protection Agency? Is that the...
There's lots of tests out there, and the tests that are sometimes approved, there's some power lobbying behind approving that test.
Right, exactly.
That's pretty much... That's the end of it right there. Where the money is. It's an independent test. I tend to look at those more than a tainted test by some of the big companies that may have a tainted interest, right? And they're the ones who have the financial wherewithal to make the bigger tests at the bigger universities and so forth.
Right.
So that's kind of how that works. Independent tests. Like where Tommy and I live on the Vancouver side, they fluoridate the water, which you guys don't have. And if you read the test, you Google that sometime, fluoridation, they don't do it in Europe. They do it here. They say it's for our teeth. That's not true.
Really?
I can brush my teeth just fine.
That's a biggie. So you brush your teeth with what?
I don't have fluoride in my toothpaste. I don't, and I filter my fluoride out of my drinking water. But if someone wants to Google that and see the history of fluoridation, it is not a pretty picture. It's basically industrial waste. They can't get rid of it. It started with the Manhattan Project. Building the bomb for World War II, that was a byproduct that they couldn't get rid of. And a doctor who worked for the Aluminum Company of America, some tainted testing that he did, approving it for teeth. And he's about the only one who's approved it. I mean, you can Google it. You read 1,000 different reports and studies saying it's toxic. So,
well, you know,
that's a big one to me.
That's a good point, because even in the Portland metro area, you know, there are activists. You know, some people might say, well, gee, I'm concerned about the whole issue of fluoridation. We went through the politics of the fluoridation aspect of it. But a lot of times they don't have the monies, if you will, to be able to fight the other side aspect of it. And again, that's another area that I plan to talk about a little bit more.
How close was the vote in Portland? Because it was just recent they tried to vote fluoridation in, and I think it narrowly failed.
Yeah, it narrowly failed.
And so hopefully we need to
revisit
failing.
That. We need to revisit that issue aspect of it. But again, you know, you start at, that's the question now. Is it a government of the people, by the people, and for the people that you elect? Because that's the whole idea with our system. You elect someone to represent the things that we're talking about. But when they get down, there's a whole different ball.
That's why I like local politics so much better. I mean, we don't have a voice with the president, really. I mean,
that's true,
but if you're the city councilman, then I do.
Yep.
Or my neighborhood,
Yep, yep.
So
we're doing that now, some other things, street stuff and this, that, and the other stuff.
Yeah.
And that, we're going through that. But the water thing is something that I think we need to bring back on the table. But from the immediate solution, you guys, in terms of water solutions, the thing that you were talking about, that's something that they can take handle on themselves.
Absolutely.
You got my point?
And affordably.
And affordably. And if there's a question about whether or not it does what it's supposed to do, you can talk to that person.
Absolutely.
You know, you guys want to say, get my money back.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
I do.
And I know that they. Let's talk a little bit about that in terms of. You said 6 cents. What is it? 3 cents a gallon?
6 cents.
6 cents.
Uh huh.
6 cents a gallon, right?
Yeah.
6 cents a gallon for that piece aspect of it.
And it's, there's no water better on the planet. There's nothing better you can drink.
And it's affordable.
I'd call that affordable.
It's very affordable.
What's a latte cost?
Oh boy, I tell you.
Maybe they're what? $4
now?
Wow. I like one once in a while, but
I don't
have one every day. Like
I don't
want
to stir it up with this big guy, you know what I mean, from the standpoint of the guy who basically makes up all these lattes and this, that, and the other. But the fact is it good for us?
Coffee's acidic, really acidic. So again, when your blood, keeping your blood at a balance, slightly alkaline, depends on what you're putting in it, how much minerals are taken. I mean, the biggest shortcut, rather than being raw food, a lot of people are raw food and vegan and all these things, and it's very difficult. You have to get fresh food every day.
Every day.
You're constantly cutting up salads. I mean, and you can stay alkaline doing that. I've seen people do that in the 70s. I saw a man who had cancer and had gone through chemo and so forth and was given a week to live. He was dead. I saw him. He was a big, tall man, about 6'4", 200, and he was down at 90 pounds. And they put him on a raw food. In those days, they used wheatgrass juice. Have you ever heard of wheatgrass juice?
No.
Extremely alkaline.
Wow.
Extremely alkaline. Started giving him that, put him on raw foods. They were flying him to Mexico where they could do some different alternative methods.
Raw food? What are you just...
Raw fruits and vegetables.
Oh,
no
raw,
meat,
thought,
nothing
I
cooked.
Raw meat.
No.
He's a yank the cow.
And they're giving him Laetrile too. And in 6 weeks, I saw it with my own eyes, he was playing tennis.
Wow.
And he lived another 14 years, started getting sloppy with his diet, and next time he couldn't beat the cancer. But I saw...
But he could afford it.
Yeah, he was a Cadillac dealer. He had money.
He had money.
Right.
The average Joe Blow don't have that kind of money.
Right, I understand.
Okay.
But I saw the power of alkalinity in that case, and that's what got me eating healthy and so forth. But it's so hard to do. I mean, drinking this alkaline water we do solves all that. You don't have to be perfect with your diet. Mm. You can have some cake once in a while. Mm-hmm, I mean, you still want a good solid diet, but you don't have to go overboard.
I don't want to get into the organic thing aspect of it, but you know, when I start thinking about the cost, how they've doubled the cost, you know, on organic foods and fruits and this, that, and the other.
Right.
I mean, there's nowhere in the world as a purist in terms of organic food. I mean, the air we breathe.
Right, true,
I mean, the water that you put on the plant.
Right,
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
That's absorbing a lot of that stuff.
Sure it is.
You know, it's about educating folks. We got to get a little bit more in terms of what we're doing.
Right.
And something that's affordable. Because if you got the money, you don't have that problem.
Right.
You
understand
what I'm saying?
Right.
But the bulk of us, the masses, don't have access to that kind of a situation.
Well, it's mainly information, and if it's affordable, I mean, there's just so much information out there that it's like wandering through a maze trying to figure all this stuff out. You know, what's right? Do I need organic? And you made some good points about buying only organic.
Yes.
You know, that even the organic's got some spray on it from the field next door.
Sure.
Right? There's no way. There's no way it doesn't.
Or the bird flying over and dropping the goodies.
Yeah, well, that's organic,
you know what I'm saying?
Or the farm workers out there.
Or how about the Chinese manufacturing with all the mercury they're putting in the air?
Oh, geez, all that big stuff that's coming out of here.
Right.
They got these big colossus crawfish. I mean, I can go on and on. That's another subject, man, aspect of it. But again, folks, what we're talking about here today is that we're talking about water, and, you know, and how can you get affordable water? That's really was my intent when I saw this crisis aspect of it. You know, a lot of folks, you know, figure out, what am I going to do? And they just ran down to the store and put their pennies together and picked up some water.
Right.
In fact, they started hoarding water.
Yeah,
they started hoarding.
Sure.
Give me four of those slots. Give me a pallet, this, that, and the other. And then after the crisis was over, they said, what am I going to do with it? And a lot of folks just threw it away.
Right. Well, there's some problems with storing plastic bottles, too.
Yes,
as far as water in plastic bottles, it's synthetic estrogen is what the chemical mimics that water pulls out of that plastic.
Right.
And that's synthetic estrogen is not something that, especially us guys, want to be to be drinking.
Yeah. I noticed that even on the bottle, it tells you it's good for so long. You know,
right.
But I paid for it. I mean, I can't drink a pallet of water in a day.
I understand.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. Or if not that, like I said, a lot of people just went back to the tap.
Right.
Soon as they said it was okay. There's a green light. Just go on, drink what you want to drink now again.
Right.
And then we're right back where we started from. You know what I'm saying?
Well, what did the city recommend? Boiling it, I guess? Or just stay off it, I guess?
A lot of them just said stay off of it.
Right.
And then, you know, who knows about boil, how much was it? You get a bubble and then you're right back. You set it aside and then.
Right. Yeah, you know. That's too tricky.
So it's really a problem aspect of it. Okay, what are some of the other, if I were to say to you that now that I need to, I'm able to, water solutions, right?
Mm-hmm.
If I got some other questions, would you have a problem if I were to let them know that they can give you a call?
No,
absolutely not. That's what we do all day, every day.
Okay, well, good. Well, we'll put that on the screen again, Dave. We'll give them, put their number on the screen. Again, this is Water Solutions. And again, Doug's number is 360-553-6240. And the other, and Tommy's number is 360-513-9820. It should be on the screen at this point in time. But like I said, if you want to know a little bit more, I mean, I've given you what I can within this hour period. But I spoke with these guys for 4 and 5 days and other folks along in the same arena, if you will, because they've got it's like anything else. We are living in a capitalist society and the economy aspect of it, and so it's a vested interest. So naturally, they're going to do out their research, and they went out and did their research and actually used the product themselves, and that makes it fair game, if you will, to look into this stuff. But water is getting to be something that's going to be, it's really high on
I think we took it for granted for so long.
Oh, yes. Yes,
and once it starts getting taken away from us,
right.
then
that's
we're
right.
in a panic, yeah, right?
Exactly.
Whether it's tainted or whatever.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly. So it's very, very important. So let's talk a little bit about, we got about another 6 minutes. Let's go back and get some highlights, if you will, and some of the things that we've been discussing.
Okay.
I'll just go around the room and just kind of wrap it up.
Okay. Well, one thing I wanted to mention real quick that
yeah,
I haven't is that our bodies are 70% water.
Okay.
Every cell is mostly water, and the interstitial fluid around that cell is water.
Mm-hmm.
So we are really just bags of water. Our brain is like 90% water.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very important. That's why the doctors tell us to hydrate. We're just basically big water balloons walking around. So we need this water. All the information, thought, and so forth is transferred through water. It's the carrier of information, the solvent, the carrier of proteins, and the carrier of waste out of those cells. So it's extremely important. Water is just should be on the top of everybody's list as far as what to do today. I got to get my 8 glasses.
You know, you make a good point. I'm just thinking about when we go back in school, when we were going to school, were you taught, if you will, about the importance
food
of water?
Food pyramid, right?
I mean, I remember that.
I never thought about water.
But never thought about water, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, again, here's an opportunity, if you will, to make sure that that's taught in our educational system.
Absolutely. Yeah. I like it.
It should be taught in our educational system.
Right.
Which is sometimes...
Right up there with the good quality
right
foods
there with
or
good
above,
quality
you know,
food
in my opinion.
Of it. I mean, it should be...
Right. And another thing, Bruce, when we're born, we're like 90% or over water. When we die, we're down to 50. Because we're all dying of dehydration.
Really?
Basically, yeah.
Wow.
Plus, being acidic, that doesn't help.
Hmm. Boy, that word just keeps coming up, and I just it blows my
it's
mind.
It's a hot term.
I'm still trying to figure out what it is. I've looked it up 1,000 times, and I've read it out the dictionary. I've Googled it, and all this other good stuff.
Well, back yes. was it 1931? A guy named Otto Warburg got mm-hmm. a Nobel Prize because he figured out the cause of all disease.
Wow!
And it's acidity.
Acidity.
Period. Otto Warburg, look him up.
Acidity.
You don't need to run for the cure anymore. They know all you need to do is be alkaline, and you won't have
wow.
the problems wow. that we've all got.
Wow. Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah, I've got an amazing story. I don't know if you guys want to hear about
it. Hold on. We got to wait in a few minutes. Go ahead.
Anyway, I had my cartilage in my knee taken out in 1971 from football. So I've been bone on bone for 40-some years, and I've been to the best surgeons in town trying to get some pain relief. Surgery is going to do you no good. You need a fake knee. So I said, well, what's the warranty? How long can that last? He said, I don't know, 5 or 10 years. I'm going, no, I'm going to go through it once. I'm going to gut it out until I'm older and then have it done.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And the pain was bad. I mean, my bone was all disintegrating around that joint and so forth. My architect told me about some alkaline water. He said, Doug, why don't you try it? I wouldn't try it because I was just ornery and didn't believe it, right? Very skeptic mm-hmm. type. And he said, put aside your thoughts for a minute and do it. So I tried it. Anyway, my osteoarthritis, my pain was gone in 10 days.
Wow.
And it's gone to this day. No artificial knee.
Wow.
So.
Wow.
Did I squeeze it in?
Wow. Wow. It was good. It was good. This has been very interesting, and hopefully the viewing audience understand where I'm coming from on this particular piece. And you know, it's like anything else. You can Google anything nowadays. But at least I wanted to kind of give you get on board, if you will, and learn a little bit more about this stuff, because everything's getting to be very expensive too nowadays.
Oh, yeah.
We right into the medical battle, if you will, and this, that, and the other, and it's just tough for the average person
mm-hmm.
to respond to good health, if you will. And here's something that for 6 cents a gallon, you pretty well solve most
right.
of your problem. You can live on water.
Absolutely.
You can almost live on water. So again, thank you all for being here with us. I appreciate that very,
thanks,
very
Bruce.
Much. And
thanks a lot, Bruce.
And I appreciate that very, very much. And to those of you out there, we want to thank you for being with us. And I might add also, too, that we will have the piece on Governor Vic Attia next week. And sorry about this, but I think this was just as beneficial. Again, thank you very much. I'll see you next week. Have a good one. Take care.